Hey guys, welcome again to the Asteroid Hunter channel. You know what? We've been gathering data, buddy. It's been good. So we're out here having a good time, but we're here with Daniel Mounsey from telescopes.net, and we're here for a worthy cause today.
Speaking of data, by the way, did you mention to the crew about their submissions?
Yeah, so we were fortunate. We've been submitting a few asteroids, some data, for the last several weeks, and we got a email back about submission for observatory code. So, which we were able to fill out that application, and we're just literally waiting for them to tell us. So we know that if we get our observatory code, then we're actually going to be official with the Minor Planet Center, which is the whole goal of what my son and I are trying to do. And I think it's so cool that we're trying to do that right outside of our garage here with our 11-inch Edge HD, you know, so.
I think it's fantastic.
Oh, the ice cream guy's driving by.
Tell him to stop in.
So it's been exciting, and we got one asteroid we're actually trying to track right now, but the challenge is it comes up, the time when I really should shoot it, it's about probably 3 in the morning, so it's I gotta.
Very faint?
No, it's about 16 magnitude, so I should be able
to
catch
it
pretty well.
Well, that would be faint for our world, for him, maybe not.
We can definitely grab that right here in our backyard, so. But we're here today for a worthy cause.
Yeah,
which is amazing. I'm so impressed with this. But we're here
too.
To talk about the Astronomers Without Borders. I apologize for that.
Yeah.
Astronomers Without Borders.
Yeah.
And we're here for a worthy cause. And you brought us some cool stuff to check out.
Yeah,
here today,
Mike Simmons and I go back a long way. He runs Astronomers Without Borders. He's in Calabasas, California. And it's amazing. He travels all over the world, and it's all about awareness of science and astronomy. And the proceeds of these scopes go, they're only $200 scopes. I'm going to show you all the features about them. And all the proceeds go to help the organization exist and to keep it going.
So cool.
Yeah, and Mike's a great guy. I've known him for a long time, and he had sent me this scope, and he's like, hey, take a look at it and see what you think. And it's embarrassing to say, but I opened it today, finally, we could do it here, to do a presentation on the scope. And it's just funny when you look at it. I looked over the features and everything, and it is astonishing. I am not kidding you. And I mean this sincerely, you could not spend $200, on a better telescope than what this thing is. And you'll see all the features that it has. One of the things here is that it's very portable. So it's very light.
Yeah.
And if you want to take it and put it on a picnic bench or travel somewhere with it, it's a 5-inch F5 Newtonian. It's 650 millimeter focal length, 130 millimeters of aperture here. And you see the mount that it's on is the Dobson mount, which has been around for decades. It's a very popular mount. But it's an effective way of getting a little bit of extra aperture without having a tripod. Low-cost tripod-mounted scopes tend to be a little flimsy, and Dobson mounts are just the opposite. They're very solid. That's what they're known for their stability, because you can put a lot of aperture on them, and they go up to huge apertures, like 48 inches.
Right.
So this one's 5, as I mentioned, and the way this works is there's two screws here that you loosen right here. And this allows the upper cage assembly to come up like this.
That's great.
Yeah, and it moves up real easily, and it stays in collimation very well. Collimation is something you do when you align the mirrors so that the images of the stars look sharp. And it has all the basic fundamental features that I'm going to go over that you want to see in a Dobson mount. This one has a Vixen-style plate on it, which we call V-plate for short. And what this does is I loosen this screw, and I can remove the optical tube assembly from the mount. So you can see just the mount on its own. This is the Dobson mount.
Yeah, yeah.
This is a Newtonian reflector, Isaac Newton.
Right.
I know all about Isaac Newton.
Yep.
And this this telescope design has been around for hundreds of years. So you just get a good balance point here. You put this in the saddle plate here and just find a balance point that looks that feels just about right. There's a little safety screw here so that if it's loosened, it doesn't slide and fall all the way through.
Right, right.
So you can just kind of get it to the balance point that you like. There's a tension knob here that adjusts so you can get the right amount of tension on it to your liking. Now, interestingly, what was funny about this when I was cracking up, I was like, hey, there's no dust cap on here.
Oh,
right?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
But there doesn't need to be, because watch what happens when I drop it down. This is kind of funny. When I drop it down, it's closed.
Right.
So it doesn't matter. This cap protects it. So you don't need a desk cap for there. That was the first
Nothing
thing that kind
of
stood out.
Of course.
It's very clever. So it hides in there.
What do you think this, what does this weigh, think?
I mean, the whole thing to me probably feels about maybe 15 pounds, 12 pounds?
I mean,
I don't even know if it's that.
12, I mean, can you, what'd you say this was,
F5.
F5.
Yeah.
Like, can you, I mean, you guys with bigger telescopes, I think you could probably saddle this thing on there too, man, you know? Listen to me, man. Like, let's put a camera on that bad boy and let's do some imaging.
Hey, watch it, right? Man. This is analog astronomy.
Come on, man. That's all you imagers out there.
We're doing astronomy unplugged,
That's
guys.
That's what I'm doing, you know.
We're doing astronomy unplugged here with this little guy. So here's your mirror. Let me take the dust cap off here. All right, and just explain a little bit about the optical path. Here, I'm gonna just slide it forward a little bit to get my desired balance point here.
This is so great. $200.
$200.
$200, guys.
Right, for this.
You
and you're funding a good cause, you know? So it holds 1.25 inch, 1.25 inch eyepieces. It's all you need, because remember, the focal length's only 650. So even with these small 1.25 inch eyepieces with these little barrels, you get these huge swaths of the sky.
Yeah.
So it's not an issue whatsoever. People often ask about baffling a Newtonian. And if you look here, this is very clever. There's a little baffle that protrudes here. And the reason that you want that is because as the light enters in the top and bounces up the bottom off of here, you want the background behind the eyepiece to be dark. That's the strategic location of the baffle.
Right.
Doing it here doesn't do very much.
Right, right.
But when you do it here, it makes a huge difference. If you didn't have this little light baffle here that you see, then you would get light scatter from the outside entering into the baffle of the eyepiece, which you don't want. It adjusts real easy. It moves super smooth. And let me tell you a little bit about the way this works here. There's a star pointer up here. The idea of the star pointer is that it projects a little red dot onto a window display. So you look through that. Once you align it, there's a little adjustment screw here. This is your left and right adjustment. So it adjusts it left and right. The one down below here allows adjustment for the finder scope to move up and down. And then, of course, you have your on-off switch, which is right there and projects a red dot on there. And usually you want to have the red dot at the lowest setting so that you can see the stars through the glass window of the little red dot finder itself. Another cool feature is the secondary does have collimation, allow for a collimation in here. So if you need to make little adjustments to that. It's preset at the factory, so it should be pretty good. I already looked at the collimation. It was right perfect, almost perfect, right out of the box. It only required about half a turn on one of the screws here. And I'll tell you about these little screws on the backside of the telescope here. There's six push-pull system, screw system here. And you'll see here, these longer screws here are your locking screws. The shorter ones are the thumb screws, which allow the optics to be adjusted so that tilts the primary mirror in different directions, whichever the desired direction is. And then once you've done that, you just apply finger-tight pressure to the locking screws so that the mirror stays in place. You don't need
down,
to crank it down. Just finger-tight is fine, is all you'll need. I mean, you don't even
have
to.
The mirror doesn't weigh too much, so.
Exactly, right? So, you know, it's not a big deal. Also, the primary mirror, did I drop something?
Yes. No, I did. Something fell off the table.
No worries.
Fine there.
The primary mirror is center dotted, which is an important feature because when you're using a Cheshire collimator, which is what this little device is in my hand, this is like a little sight tube. And what you do is you look through this and you see a reflection of the little central dot on the primary mirror. And all you have to do is adjust the screw so it's perfectly centered. It's really intuitive. You can literally almost tell what you need to do just by looking at it.
I'm just still blown away that this is $200.
$200
for what you get.
And these are Cinta optics. The optics are great. You can see the rings on Saturn with it. I already know I could see up to several bands on Jupiter on a good seeing night. I know I would because I've seen Newtonians of this caliber and this small size.
Right.
What they can do. You can even do it with these rare Edmund reflectors that are only like four inches. So there's a lot of potential even with a little scope like this. Now there's two eyepieces in the kit. There's absolutely nothing you need to make the scope work. And right out of the box, it comes with the manual. It also has a little brochure about AWB, Astronomers Without Borders, and what the organization represents, what it's about, and that sort of thing. And then the eyepieces I want to talk about. And this is where some of the questions are. Now, there's desk caps for the eyepieces. They include a 5 millimeter wide-angle eyepiece and a 10 millimeter. Now, all you do to determine the magnification of the telescope, which you know this, but is you take the focal length of the telescope and you divide it by the focal length of the eyepiece, and that will yield the magnification of the telescope. So all I do here is you always want to start out with the eyepiece that has the higher number on it, because that gives you the brightest image and the widest field and the most comfortable view. And you have to remember something about eyepieces here. Both of these have really good eye relief if you look, even the 10 millimeter. And the 10 millimeter, by the way, is truly a wide-angle eyepiece. It's right. Not like a normal Plossel or Ortho, which is an eyepiece design I'm referring to. But you get two eyepieces with it, and the collimator, you get the dust cap, and you get little dust caps for the eyepieces in there. Now, you start out with this eyepiece here, and you do most of your deep sky viewing you'll do with this eyepiece. And to adjust it, it has a helical focus. The way a helical focuser works is the eyepiece gets inserted and you rotate this little gizmo bob here, the little helical focus here. And it just rotates in and out so you can achieve focus with it. And it's just the most classic, simple design. Now this would be, this type of eyepiece you would use to look at like the Milky Way, or if you want to see like wide star clusters and things of that sort. But once you get planets come around, you want higher magnification, you're going to want the 10 millimeter. So you just take this little eyepiece out, you pop the 10 millimeter eyepiece. And by the way, when I say wide field, I sincerely mean that. Just to give you an example, your peripheral vision, you know, picks up what, 170, 180 degrees? It depends. Everybody's a little different. But eyepieces have fields of view too. They have like 50 degree, they have 60 and 70 and 80 and 100, goes way out here. So this eyepiece, the 10 that's in there, it looked to me like something like 60 degrees of apparent field. So what happens is the planet will stay in the field of view for a longer duration of time before you have to move the telescope
right
to keep it centered, because it's a wide field eyepiece. So that's one of the cool things about it. So right out of the box, it's just a very nice telescope.
Well, and here's the thing. I mean, let me.
We're
going
to go into how you observe it.
Do I have it here?
I brought Night Watch.
Did you?
Yeah.
Well, I have a Newton book floating around here.
Oh yeah. I mean, it's funny, we take it for granted, but this design was developed by Isaac Newton back in the day.
I have it. It might be in my other library. I have, as you guys can see, I have.
Oh, Mike's got an extensive library, but I brought a few of my own personal books.
I'm very into the history of this stuff.
Mike's totally into the history.
I love this.
He's like an astronomy historian.
Yes, I'm fascinated. Yeah, I appreciate it. Well, my thing is, and we've talked about this extensively, I'm so fascinated by 16th, 17th century astronomers.
It's incredible.
The stuff that they did with just little.
So amazing
what they were able to accomplish and the stuff they measured and different things and they were pretty dead on in a lot of ways, you know, and it's just pretty incredible to me. And then a lot of them, I mean, some of them, you know, gave their lives. Some of them,
they would
spend months going to a location and it would be cloudy, you know, because they're taking a measurement, or they would take, you know, months because back then you couldn't just hop on an airplane and go be like, oh, you know, I'm going to go over here and take some, you know, I'm going to view in this spot in the world. It's like, no, they had to travel for months and they would die.
Look what astronomers went through for Einstein's theory of relativity, the whole thing about warpage around the sun. People, these photographers are using the craziest stuff. They had to go out to fields to take photographs of these eclipses to see if they can see the.
For the longest time, we thought that because of, you know, Einstein ended up helping us out. But for years, we thought that there was another planet between, you know, Mercury and Sun that was called Vulcan.
Yeah.
Because the orbit of Mercury is a little wonky compared to the others. So they thought there was a pole there. But based on, you know, what Einstein theory, we figured that out. But my whole point of that is that this really is grassroots.
This is grassroots.
Really just understanding how telescopes truly work for a few hundred bucks. And I mean, for people that are starting out, even me who, man, I love this. I've got all kinds of crazy stuff, but I look at this and go, man, you know, this just really puts you in touch with kind of the basics of what it's all about. And, you know, you have a great mirror, a great little setup here. You go out and you can just enjoy the sky what it's worth out there. And it's 200
bucks. Like, you can't beat it. The fundamental things that you need in a telescope are here, and it's solid to boot. You know, it's a very stable platform. It doesn't shake.
You're going to get to it. Really what it's about. We're the 200 bucks. This is for a worthy cause. This is not like, hey, you buy one from the store and you get it from the store. There's a worthy cause behind this.
Yeah. I don't even think we even carry the scope. So yeah. We're doing this for AWB. I'm doing this for Mike Simmons and his organization because I love what they represent. I love what they do. And actually, Farah is one of the board members there.
Okay.
Awesome. And several of the people that we work with also are part of this organization.
Farah's the owner of telescopes.net, Woodland Hills Cameron Telescope.
Yeah. So she's done a lot of contributions to Mike as well. They sometimes get donations of telescopes, which we help sell, and those funds go towards funding this organization, AWB. So we're really proud of that, and we want to continue to support this organization as long as we can, because we want to promote astronomy. We want people to become more aware of science and astronomy, because I think it's a great thing for kids to get into as well. Yeah. And these are great for kids. I'm hoping Benjamin, my 4-year-old son, once he gets old enough, I'm hoping that he'll be able to use a scope. I'm going to loan it to Mike and his family for a little while, because his daughter's 8 years old.
Yeah.
And, you know, she could probably work with it a little bit. And if you have like a picnic table or a little stool, just put it outside or put it on a hood of a car or back of
Brent, my son, who's 14 and is in this crazy thing that we're doing together, you know, he's actually on the other side of this wall, Brandon.
He's running the stream. We gotta get him on the camera at some point.
Brandon, why don't you get up and just say hi to
everybody.
Just come over here, say hi.
He's a little
buddy.
Guy in the.
He's bless his heart. He hasn't been feeling too well lately, but.
I've known Brandon since he was a tiny little tot coming into the store.
Yeah, my 14-year-old son is involved in this, and you know what's crazy is we got cameras all over this garage/man cave/observatory, and the stream running. He's the guy in the background making it all happen.
He is. You
he really
believe
is.
It.
He's running all this
Who
stuff,
would have thought
man.
That little kid
I know.
Would have done
he's
this?
Like, so he's on the other side running the stream, checking, watching the chat, doing all this kind of stuff for us. So, you know, we're grateful. But you know what Brandon said when he saw this?
Yeah.
He goes, oh, man, that reminds me of my first ETX set I got.
It does ETX look like 90, an ETX 125 or 90
like,
or something.
It's
you know?
Just that kind of basic grassroots thing. You know, it's like, oh, it's a little tabletop, you know, deal. But I tell you what, you know.
I'm going to tell you more about it.
Yeah, tell him more. So, but it's just great because I'm a Newton fan, you know.
Oh, me too.
And just the contributions and just what would he?
Newtonians are like the most efficient and lowest cost way of collecting
amazing,
light
amazing,
in a good way.
You know.
And you got it, sir.
Thanks, buddy.
And we'll talk about a couple of different scope designs here. We're talking about this one here. As a Newtonian, because it's an effective way of collecting light. So what can you see with this? And people are like, you know, think, well, because it's a small aperture, you can't see a lot. But really, if you go from the city, you can see, you know, several bright star clusters, and you can see the planets. You can easily see the rings of Saturn. You only need about 25, 30 times to actually start to resolve the rings of Saturn. And this thing will magnify up to a couple of hundred times. So you can see the moons orbiting Jupiter, Io, Europa, Ganymede, Callisto, and you know you could see a ton of stuff with that. Think about what Isaac Newton saw with just a tiny little, you know, piece of metal.
Yeah, no,
that
even
was polished metal.
Yeah,
you know?
Galileo. I remember you know? when I talked about Galileo. Poor Galileo, man. He thought Saturn had ears. You know, he called it the planet with ears.
Know.
You know,
poor, never lived
poor
long
Galileo,
enough
you know?
To realize what those ears
yeah,
were.
He didn't know what
I
those
always
ears
thought
were.
About that. So amazing. So how do you find things? I'll tell you this. You can Google Stephen O'Meara, S-T-E-P-H-E-N, O'Meara, O-M-E-A-R-A, Stephen O'Meara. And this guy is really an amazing visual astronomer. I love him. I think he said he was an early century observer stuck in a modern century.
Yeah.
Because he just only likes to view visually, and he only wants to sketch. That is it. And his eyes are so well-seasoned and so, sensensitive. And he's just trained himself to be an amazing observer. He even drew spokes on Saturn's rings. And nobody really, they couldn't, it was kind of dismissed because nobody believed it. Because until the Voyager spacecraft went by and verified that it was true.
Right.
So what was drawn in historical drawings through telescopes actually was later verified through satellites. And true. And the reason I bring up Stephen O'Meara is because he has several amazing books. One's called The Messier Objects. He has another one. These are the Deep Sky Wonders books. And he has one called The Caldwell Objects and several others that are really amazing books. And the reason I am mentioning this is because if you want to just sit down and read about astronomy and read about observations, you appreciate the subtleties and things that you see. And now Mike and Brandon and Mirko and several others, we're, you know, we talk a lot about the camera side of things, but today we're talking about visual side for a change. And this is one way to do it. Now, there's a popular book, I brought it with me, is Night Watch. Now, if you Google the book Night Watch, it gets 5-star ratings down the board. It was written by Terence Dickinson, who's a very well-known amateur astronomer in Canada. And he was actually knighted in Canada. So,
you got to keep me in check.
Sir Terence Dickinson. But this book is one of the biggest selling astronomy books ever. I have literally sold thousands of copies.
This is the newer version, basically?
That's the newer version. There's a version earlier than this one. Mine's the older version. This is the newer one.
New one.
Now, the reason you may want the newer one is because it keeps you up to speed on, like, solar events, meteor showers, things of that, where you need to go to dark skies to see these things, of course. But it gives you tutorials on the night sky by season. And unlike a computer, okay, you can go unplugged. You can get a red flashlight and read these charts in the dark. But if you look on this book, there's seasons here.
Right.
So they go winter, spring, summer, fall, and then it highlights the constellations that are visible at the certain time. And then you go inside, and there's detailed maps inside. And the purpose of these detailed maps is so that you know where to point the star pointer in the telescope relative to those constellations so you can see things in the telescope. You don't always see everything. Some people, when they start out, they don't see anything. And you know, because you know, Mike's an observer too, so he can tell you from firsthand experience as well. The funny thing is that the spring season is when everybody starts wanting to observe more. And the saddest part about the spring season is it's also called galaxy season.
Right.
And that's where you're looking up out of the plane of the Milky Way, away from all the matter that resides along the path of the Milky Way itself. So you're looking up out of the plane of the galaxy and you see more galaxies outside of our own. And those objects are very faint. So if you go to a dark sky, you can see a lot of faint galaxies. You could probably see up to 40 or 50 galaxies, probably even more, in the Virgo cluster with this telescope. With a trained eye, in a dark sky location, you could do it. But I highly recommend this book called Night Watch by Terence Dickinson. The newer version is the one that Mike showed you just a moment ago. This book is the number one book that I recommend for this. The other one that's good is called Turn Left at Orion. That's a wonderful book. And there's probably a lot of beginner books, but Turn Left at Orion and Night Watch are probably the dominating books out there. And I have sold literally thousands of copies of this book to people. So
it's cool too, because you got a book, yours is marked up. You put notes on. I'm the same way. I've got the one I just pulled out had some notes in there. They do, and I encourage people. It's like, people don't really like to go to books.
They love
to have their phones, and those are all great tools, for sure. But it's kind of neat when you can, write on your book or make notes and make marks and do some stuff in there and have it with you. And Daniel made me appreciate years ago of kind of setting up and a table and having some books and doing some things. And these are things before Brandon and I even started hunting asteroids, we would set up here and I would pull, and I know you're gonna cover Burnham's, would open some books and we would look at something and we would just talk about it. And I would read the books. Hey, here's what it says about this, specific cluster or something we're looking at.
Yeah.
And we would go through and look, it just was neat, but because the books give the history I would put pages down and write notes. I mean, I had a logbook where I kind of wrote some notes on stuff we were seeing, and you just kind of spend some time. A lot of people, I know you've done this. People look at the eyepiece, they draw a picture of what they see,
and
you just got to spend time. I think observing is all about just taking it in, you know, and just seeing. You're not going to get that immediate gratification. You look through the eyepiece, you're not going to see this big, like, Hubble image going on. I think a lot of people expect
that. Or they want that.
And they want that. And I get it. I understand. But there's something about, you know, especially when I've seen a lot of videos where Daniel's really talking about going to a specific site and just kind of really settling in.
Yeah.
And just taking it in. And it's like, and everything's just quiet.
It's a personal connection that you have with nature.
And it's neat, man. Yeah. And Brian and I have had the opportunity where we've actually done some of that. And I got to say, I mean, it's like, it is really nice, man.
It is.
Like,
you take a couple of camping chairs, pair of binoculars, and just go out and sit and relax. And just look at the sky and dream. You don't have to make it complicated. Just look at it with your own eyes.
That's true.
You know, your pupils dilate. Your eyes are telescopes. You know, they dilate to, you know, 5, 6, 7 millimeters, whatever. And take it in and look at it. Look at the colors of the stars. Look at Tycho Brahe, you know, or you can look at history.
Guys were making discoveries with stuff like smaller than this. And let's get something out of the way right now. People look at this and go, oh, I need something bigger to really look at the sky. No, tell the story about the guy with the ETX-80 who...
this is funny. I tell you about that guy that blew me away?
Well,
So the guy had a little ETX-80. That's a small telescope.
And this is smaller than this.
Smaller than this.
Yeah.
And I have a lot of experience in the forums, you know, on Cloudy Nights, which is funny because I've been a member of Cloudy Nights, I think, since 2002. And... it was funny, somebody posted a thing, can you take pictures of the ETX? And this is a little telescope. It's like 80 millimeters, you know? It's like this little thing I'm going to show you behind me. And I was like, nah, there's, you know, it wouldn't be the right choice for taking pictures. So this veteran imaging guy, and I have a lot of experience with forms and stuff. This guy just blew me away. I felt like a little child after this guy was done with me. This guy was, and I never forgot it, he was imaging deep sky objects with this ETX-80. And not only was he imaging deep sky, he was imaging quasars. I mean, it's just absurd. I mean, it's just crazy. And quasars are faint, but to take the time to designate them in your images is just mind-blowing, you know?
Yeah.
And quasars are, they're not hundreds of millions, they're billions of light years away.
Yeah.
You know, they're very distant objects. And this guy was imaging them with a little scope.
And I'm really always really fascinated by as I'm reading these books about, you know, guys this and that. But then I'll kind of dig farther into history of stuff, and I'll find out that a lot of stuff guys were looking at, a lot of things were cataloged.
Yes.
1,000 years before that from people that had nothing but just them looking
at Babylonians.
Like, are you kidding me?
The ancient Egyptians.
And they were, like, mapping stuff.
Yeah.
And they were getting it right, man. Like,
it's
like they
amazing.
Were seeing this stuff. And
the
it's
celestial
like,
mechanics. Yeah. I mean, they paid close attention
to it. Incredible.
They
didn't have a telescope.
In fairness to our modern culture, one of the things I do sympathize with our modern culture is light pollution.
Yeah, we don't have dark, right.
God, do a satellite map and you see the whole eastern side of the United States is polluted with light. And it's really unfortunate. But there is a positive thing you can think about, and that is what I do. Is I spend a lot of time enjoying double and multiple stars. I look at carbon stars and variable stars, and I look at the moon, and I look at the planets, all from the comfort of my own home, and it's the most ideal place. And we're here in Los Angeles, and people don't know this, but Mount Wilson was constructed above Los Angeles, and in the mountain region up there behind Los Angeles, behind Hollywood. And the reason for that was because of the onshore air breeze that you would get from and the inversion layer, and you get this beautiful, steady air scene from the ocean. It makes your air stability, you know, nice and still, and that's what you want. You want the air stability to be solid and not moving around, as you know.
Yeah.
You know? And so, you know, you can view planets from a city. If you, it doesn't matter. The light pollution doesn't hurt you at all.
Well, we did a video.
It's fun to be
last video we did, we imaged.
Talked about it.
Right here.
Yeah.
Right out of our backyard.
Yeah, you can do stuff. You can do narrowband imaging.
I mean, look, I'm measuring asteroids.
Yeah.
From my backyard.
90%.
Pretty amazing.
Dude, 90. It is, and it's a great thing that we have it. And 90% of my observing I do from the city in Los Angeles.
I've been to his house and viewed from there, and I'm like, are you kidding me? Like LAX is. Yeah.
I have an observatory.
Right up the road.
I have a roll-off roof observatory.
The best view of Saturn I ever experienced in my life.
Yeah.
Was in your driveway.
Oh yeah, it was a long time ago. It was a big scope though. I think the 20-inch. We had a 20-inch Starmaster.
The Starmaster, yes. But man, I mean, it was incredible.
Yeah, that thing makes Saturn look like a silver.
Oh, I tell people that the rings were like, it was like looking at a record.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Like it just was like it was. I'd never experienced that, and I literally could hear the planes taking off from LAX.
Oh yeah, I don't hear them anymore.
Oh man, I'm like, there's planes flying over us landing, and we're sitting here. I mean, it was incredible.
Yeah, under really subarc second, amazing scene conditions. So. So yeah, you can definitely, you know, enjoy looking through a small scope. And maybe if you just want to go out casually, just go out in the patio or something and just look at the moon or something, look at the craters. Yeah. And I brought a book, The Ruckel Atlas, and I think it's over there. It's this one here. Now, this book varies in price. It's very bizarre.
Are we okay, Brandon? How are we doing?
Sounded good.
Any questions in
any
the chat?
Technical any technical malfunctions?
Yeah.
No, that's okay.
We're live streaming. Things happen. That's all I can say.
So this is the book I used to look at the moon, The Ruckel Atlas of the Moon. And this book can go, sometimes it varies in price. Sometimes it's $400. I've seen it $400. I've seen it $25. It varies, depends on the availability, because this one is discontinued. I think Sky Publishing has the rights to it now, and it's under the Sky Publishing name. But it has these drawings and stuff in it, you know, computer-rendered drawings, and they're fantastic. And in the back, there's like a glossary and there of stuff and interesting highlights of the moon. And you know, sometimes you can spend literally hours just viewing the moon.
Yep.
The problem people with observing is people just point and just glance at the moon and maybe see some craters in it. But you can really get enveloped in just viewing it all night. And I do it, and it's very relaxing, and it's just a very enjoyable thing to do. And as you continue further on, I wanted to mention a couple other books for our people watching here. One is called...
I haven't seen this one.
Yeah, this book is amazing, okay? It's about... You can get it for pretty low cost online, probably for maybe 10 bucks, you know? And Craig Crossan is an amazing observer. He's an amazing author, and he's a friend, and he's a wonderful person. And I've had numerous exchanges with him about this book, and it's just so beautifully written and so beautifully done, because he makes you appreciate looking through binoculars. You can take binoculars, and he talks about the Pipe Nebula, you know, in Ophiuchus, and all these dark nebula that you can see with a pair of binoculars, things that you cannot see with a telescope, actually, because of the restricted field of view. With binoculars, you get this big swath. So if you get out to a dark sky, you see the Milky Way. I strongly recommend binocular astronomy. So this is a really nice book here. Another book, which I wanted to mention to you, is this little guy here. Now, In Starland with a 3-inch Telescope. Crazy. William Olcott, amazing observer. In Starland with a 3-inch Telescope. The real book itself, the actual book, is pretty small. It's about this big. I think it was written in 1912 or something like that. And he highlights all the stars, double stars and multiple stars, that are bright and easy to resolve in small telescopes like this. So there are sources. You can use computer programs like Sky Safari. I highly recommend Sky Safari if you do insist on, you know, wanting an app. You have Sky Safari, don't you?
Yeah, I use it all the time, actually.
There's also Stellarium, if you want to use Stellarium. I like Sky Safari. It's my favorite, but people have different ones they like. This other book here is called Sky Vistas. This one is also written by Craig Crossan, and unfortunately extremely expensive. It's about $100. But this book by Craig Crossan, the same author, I took the book apart and actually put it in a folder, in a binder, and opened the pages. And it has paragraphs on each object. See, the thing is if you sit down and you take the time to read, and that's what I would do. I would go to a coffee house and sit down and read Burnham Celestial Handbook, which I'm going to pull up in just a moment. And I would sit there and just read about one or two or three stars and look at those three objects just in one night. It's not a lot of objects, but you're really thinking about it, you're really taking it in, you're really appreciating what it is you're seeing, the subtleties, you know, and that's what it's about. So if you ever think you need a GPS or a modern telescope, you know, look at this. You know, there's nothing on it, and you can still have a lot of fun with it. There's no computers, there's no aid. It's a very reliable system for $200. So this is an awesome book. Now, this is one telescope design, and we can talk about another one, which is a refractor, which we have behind me.
Real quick, before we go there, I just want to tell people, Brandon, do you have that website?
Yeah, put up Astronomers Without Borders.
Without Borders. So they see where they can order the thing from?
Yeah, from Astronomers.
And again, talk about a little bit where the money goes for the purchase.
All of the funds go towards, you know, these organizations that they do internationally. I mean, they work all around the world. You know, Mike Simmons has been all over the world. So these funds go towards supporting programs to get children, to get kids into astronomy and science. It's creating awareness. That's the key element.
Around the world, it's basically,
science,
right?
Around the world.
Around the world.
You know, I mean, it amazes me where Mike Simmons goes. And it's really funny because Mike and I go out to New York each year to attend NEAF, the Northeastern Astronomical Forum, which is the biggest trade show in the United States of here. And it's so funny because I was just, you know, I was telling Mike, Mike and I always seem to catch each other on the airplane. We always end up being on the same flight for some reason. And it's just the funniest thing. I don't know how many times that's happened, but I've lost count. But it's just so funny, you know. So anyway, it's portable. When you're done, just drop it down, tighten the little screws. You put your little dust cap on. This. Make sure when you're done, you turn your star pointer off. It clicks on and off.
Oh, that's,
you know, you're going to need it for how many?
I keep buying batteries. I need to buy a stock of batteries because I leave those things on so often.
Unless you can find a way to retrofit a Telrad to this thing somehow.
Exactly right.
Telrad. Telrad. It was developed by Steve Kuhfeld in the 70s. And they're very popular. And camera guys use them in Hollywood, too, as well, for cameras. It's just a pointing device. So this is a Newtonian reflector. We've kind of gone over the Newtonian reflector. Is there anything you want to add before I move on?
No, I just think, you know, it's just such a neat deal for the money. It's going to a great cause. You know, we showed you the website. I'll put a link to it down below as well.
And Brandon, do we have it up on the website right now?
He had it up there a little bit ago. So,
Good.
But you know, guys, check this out. You're looking to get into it, or even if you've been in the hobby for a lot of years.
Yeah.
You know, it's just such a great thing for a great cause.
It's a great cause. Support the program. And, you know, and Mike Simmons is a great guy.
Such a neat deal, you know.
Yeah.
I just think I'm blown away at the instrument you get for $200. I mean, and I know that I could take this outside, set it up, and I could see, I mean.
You can see a lot of things if you spend a little time to appreciate what you can see.
It'd be amazing.
It'll be amazing.
That's so
absolutely
cool.
So I'm just going to set this aside, and we're going to pull up a different little telescope and just talk about it briefly.
It's called the ETX-80, right?
What's that?
No, this one here is the AW.
What's the other scope that kind of looks like it?
Oh, the ETX.
Yeah, the ETX.
Yeah, the ETX-125. I'll just put this over here. I'm just going to move this little guy over here.
The 125?
Yeah, it looks the same size as the ETX-125.
Kind of same size.
Interestingly.
But that's a different design.
Yeah, the ETX-125 is a Russian design called the Maksutov.
Maksutov.
So I'm just going to move this over here.
Oh, we're going with
a little refractor.
We're going with the talk though, man, which is like.
Well, we're actually just going to talk about this little scope
because
people
at this little stool.
People don't believe me. Is it centered pretty well?
What? Oh yeah, that's good.
Okay.
Pretty good. Let me check
the other camera real quick.
Okay.
Yeah, that looks good.
Cool. All right. The reason I'm showing you this. There's a couple of reasons. This is a refractor design instead of a Newton design. And the reason I brought this is because this is my own personal telescope. It's only 60 millimeters. It's a little fluorite crystal doublet. So it's a very lightweight, portable telescope. It can be also used for imaging, but it has a polar scope. It has a finder scope. It's very portable. I can just move it around. Oops, sorry about that. It can move it around. It's got a little polar scope here, and it moves. There's a little clutch system here to move it like so. So you can move it in various directions. But the point I want to make is, I mean, one, I'm going to give you a brief rundown on refractors because that's another alternative design that you can look with, but also to show you that even I use a small telescope. This is smaller. This collects less light than that does. I can spend an entire night looking through this telescope, no problem. And all the things that I look at in particular are double stars. This is the chair. The reason I brought this little chair is to just show you it's portable. So I just grab it and go with it. I have other chairs. I have like all the fancy chairs and hardware.
Old though. It's like a cane when you walk out.
I know, that's the thing. You're gonna be feeling tired by the time you're off. But it's
awesome.
So light and it works so perfect. And it's like the combination of this setup, and it does that. And it's got a little tracking motor on it There's no computer assist on here. There's no go-to. There's no GPS.
But
no
it will nothing. Track.
But it tracks.
Yeah.
It tracks. You pull it, align it to the North Star, so it's parallel to the Earth's axis, and it will track the stars. And that's what the purpose of the little baby polar scope is for, you know.
This is kind of the big thing, especially now. There's
yeah.
Well, I know Mirko just went out to the Death Valley with a help me again. It's the Skywatcher
Star Adventure.
Star Adventure.
Do we
right?
have those images aside the show?
Yeah, I'll be able to show those in a bit. But show basically, those. It's you know he's got a camera tripod much like this, and he's got yeah. this thing you put on there, and you can just put a DSLR yeah. camera with really any lens you want.
Yeah.
And it's got the same kind of system where it just tracks the sky. And I could tell he's really getting into shooting the Milky Way. There's a lot of guys. And yeah, we're kind of coming into that season right now.
Portable setup.
You know, portable setup. We're gonna the season's coming where you actually go out in dark sky location. Yeah, because
the Milky Way is starting to rise out. And he got Roe Fiucus region. He took beautiful pictures.
Incredible.
With a small system very much like this. It's a tracking device. This does the same thing where it just tracks the stars. And you put a wide-angle lens on it, a camera lens on it, and you can take... It's too bad we didn't, you know, set the images aside to actually, to show. It would have been kind of cool. I have them on my iPhone, but Mirko texts them over to me.
Well, they're on, Brandon, are they on the Discord under his page there?
Yeah, I think
do you see him?
Yeah.
I think he posted them up
He did several shots that just blew me away. I don't know if Marco's watching right
Guys,
now.
Guys, here's the other thing. Let me put a plug in real quick. So, Brandon, did you put a link to the Discord? If you're watching, you like what you see. We do all kinds of different videos. Brandon and I we track asteroids. We show that stuff. We're also grateful because we're sponsored by telescopes.net. So we like to bring Daniel in. We bring other guests in to just talk about the equipment for all kinds of various.
I mean,
things,
at some point
you know?
We should have Mike Simmons come in.
Mike Simmons.
We have Brian Cogdell from Celestron is going
to
be visiting.
I think maybe next weekend he'll be visiting us. Yeah. We're trying to get him in, but lots of various people on because we. There's so many areas of astronomy. You know?
There is. You're doing asteroids. Mirko's doing imaging. I'm doing
visual. All
We're
kinds
crazy.
Of stuff. And
Simon's doing the sun.
The sun.
Yeah.
So we just want to show all those things. You know, yeah. I even put an email the other day. I was trying to reach out to the Catalina Sky Survey guys who are actually the ones that really do the real asteroid tracking because I'm trying to get them on
the
show.
Cool.
You know? So,
are you? Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, but we're just trying to show all kinds of various things. And but if you like what you see, please subscribe, man. And but also join the Discord. We have the Discord there that you can basically go in there. You can ask questions. I post news. I also post equipment that's on sale from telescopes.net any given time. Mirko, who's kind of the resident imager that we use, that we're with and is great friends of the channel, he's gracious enough to share a lot of his images that he posts up and stuff out there. So get into the... to the Discord and join it, and then
Mirko's
please subscribe,
using
man.
Equipment.
It's awesome.
Mirko's using equipment to image with, and we loaned him a Star Adventure, and I was just blown away. I think one or two days later, he came back, and I couldn't believe it.
So
later, we'll post that.
Real quick, just so people are clear, because I know right now they're looking in the image, they're seeing our 8x8-inch, Schmidt that they have. So just so we're clear, this is a refractor. That's a Schmidt Cassegrain. There's two different designs going on here. I just want to let people know. There's two different things.
Yeah, we'll
here
talk
that you're
about
there
that
too.
In a
you know, so
we'll do that. I mean, the thing is, people like. Sometimes I have a specific reason for you using a small scope. I don't know if you knew about Antares, but it was an occultation between Antares and the Moon, where there. I don't know if you saw it. It just skimmed.
It was
incredible.
Really.
This is the scope I had out to look at the event,
okay.
And it was mind blowing to see it. Because you could see Antares like skimming across the Moon. Antares is a star, a large red giant star in Scorpius. And to see that event, this is what you would have wanted because you would have that wide field and you can see the star just so close. And there's a lot of history between these conjunctions and stuff of planets and the Moon and stars and things. It can be very interesting to watch it, see it visually yourself with your own eyes. But what I've done, if you want to grab a copy of Burnham's, it doesn't matter.
Your copies.
It doesn't matter.
Daniel doesn't use these books at all. You can tell. I mean, these are like pristine, these things. I mean, he doesn't. Oh, my gosh.
So, the whole point, I think I have a constellation that's highlighted. And the point that I want to bring to your attention here is, so what I'm doing here, let me just see if I can find.
Any questions in the chat or anything, Brandon?
Constellation. No.
Okay.
That's okay.
If you guys have any questions, please feel free to poke in the chat there and ask away.
Burnham Celestial Handbook, just so that you know, because Mike has a copy of it. These are mine.
I have multiple copies.
He has multiple copies.
And I have mine, let me pull mine. Mine is spiral bound. Now I'm competing. I have they're in the folder.
Yes.
But then I also, because I love the book so much, these are the ones that I write in and do somewhat, not as extensive as you.
Keep some notes.
But then I also have the clean versions, these hardbacks that I keep pristine because those are for my other library here. So yes, cool. I have both. But
He's got them. All the guys that I'm with always have to have a copy if they want to hang out with me.
Absolutely.
They don't have a copy, I'm not going to talk to them.
Absolutely.
Like, you're not part of my club then, pal.
That's right.
These are the books I've used for 25 years. They're still at my side. I cherish them probably more than any telescope I own because my whole life and my whole history is in these books. And I've written these notes for many, many years. And not only have I written notes, I have like gone back to variable stars and countless stars. I've updated them because they, you know, things change. You know, physics change, and I don't know if the physics change, but there's new discoveries being made all the time. So that you know, Burnham said that things will change. So you're gonna have to, you know, dot them up a little bit to keep up to date on what's going on. The reason I like these books, and I'll tell you why, is because there's three volumes of it. They have a highlight. Here, you'll see I've highlighted the stars. And all these things that are highlights are things that I've observed. And all the volumes are the same way. And these are all stars that I've meticulously sat and looked at through little telescopes like this. Sometimes I need a bigger telescope because some of the stars are fainter, so it requires me to use a larger telescope. But there's one thing that happens in a small scope that doesn't happen in a big one. I'm going to tell you why and what it is. And I'll try to make it simple, but the actual diffraction or disk of a star looks more stable in an unobstructed small aperture telescope. And they call it the airy disk. It's the center. It's when you look at a star in focus, it looks like a little pinball. The smaller the telescope is, the more pinball the star will look. That's just the nature. The pinball you see has nothing to do with the scene. You know, as I mentioned before, you don't resolve stars in telescopes. All you see is the light that emanates from them. I just want to make that clear. But the way light manifests itself in the telescope is like a little pinball. And as a result, that pinball, you can see the perceived colors better. So if I were to look at star colors in this telescope and that color, the star colors are going to look more accurate in here from my perception. Because we all see color differently.
Yeah.
That's just the nature of how an optic works. The smaller the optic is, because what happens, you get too much aperture. The airy disk gets too tiny. And the light starts to scatter. Bill P. calls it woolly stars. And the bigger the scope is, the more resolving power it has, the tinier and tinier the star gets, and the more stuff you see circulating. If you go to the Pickering scale, P-I-C-K-E-R-I-N-G, Pickering scale, on Google, you'll see what the airy disk looks like, and you can see it scintillating. And when you get a bigger scope, it scintillates more, and as the scope gets smaller, the scintillating just starts to drop and dwindle. And that's what I need, because when I'm looking at stars, I need the stars to look as stable as they can and as accurately colored. You know, the color representation is to be as accurate as possible.
Right.
So that is the specific reason why I will use a scope like this. So a scope like this is a compound scope. I mean, you can probably tell people about it. I mean, you've used it. I have one myself. It's from 1973, though.
Oh yeah.
Well, I have one from 1973.
Basically, long story short with this is I've got a big focal length on this, but instead of having a big long refractor, I can take it and instead, you know, basically on a refractor, the light comes in, goes directly into your eye.
Yeah.
This one, instead of and it uses optics to kind of point the light and
there's, yeah, it's an unobstructed light path.
So, but on there, we're using mirrors, and basically light goes in and bounces up and comes back and bounces around inside the tube. So that design will allow you to basically get a lot more focal length, but you can actually take it, instead of having a huge, you know, refractor or something else, you can bring it down in that regard. And that's what really kind of what a Schmidt-Cassegrain does.
It was developed by Tom Johnson at Celestron. It's the most popular selling telescope in recreational astronomy, probably in history.
Yeah.
Is the Schmidt-Cassegrain. And I have one that I absolutely love, and it's an older version, but it works great. And I have, you know, different telescopes. I have bigger versions of these in all sizes. If I need them bigger, I got a bigger ones, you know? And Cassegrains as well, from from this particular company that manufactures these. But these are popular telescopes, and we sell these telescopes. These are the ones we sell a lot of.
Well, so. And you can see I have a Hyperstar with a camera on the front.
Yeah, you should tell me.
And that's essentially the, you know, they got mirror locks. We got, and that's the system that we're using to hunt asteroids.
Yeah.
You know?
Hyperstar.
Hyperstar, you know, and it basically it's shooting at F2. But that's
right.
If I just look at that scope through it, it's actually an F10. So I can't remember what's the focal length of an 8 just offhand. I remember
what it's 2,000
millimeters basically. But when I put a Hyperstar on it, it takes it down.
It's like
to
F2.
F2, it takes it to about 350.
It's like nothing.
Millimeters. So,
so fast, you know, and collect so much data so quickly.
So quick, and that's the whole thing because I'm in a light polluted area. I can't be taking 10, 15 minute exposures. Not to mention I'm chasing something that's moving across the sky.
Right.
So when I'm doing that, I need to do short exposures. So the Hyperstar, because it shoots at F2, it allows me to gather a huge amount of light in just a very short time. For me to gather the light that I have in a 30 to 60 second exposure, I gotta be shooting for 10 plus minutes, you know?
Right.
And I couldn't get a 10 minute, you don't shoot asteroids at 10 minute exposures. You
need even to shoot for deep sky, Marco's shooting with it.
Yeah,
and it's fast.
But you saw, I mean, the video we did last time, the last video we did a few weeks ago, we literally were shooting 10 second exposures.
Yeah.
All those videos are just 10 second exposures with that, those telescopes.
The Leo Trio.
The Leo Trio, you know.
That was amazing.
Amazing. So,
you got three galaxies, Edge On and Leo.
Yeah, but you know, again, it's all kind of what you want to do, you know.
Yeah.
There's just so many variables of it.
People don't know what they want to do.
They don't know what they want to do. That's the challenge, right?
That's the thing, is like, you, what scope am I choosing me? But the problem with that beginners have is they don't know what questions to ask.
Yeah.
You know, you can always find out a person's level of knowledge by the questions they ask, because they'll usually ask the wrong questions, and that's fine. I was asking the wrong questions too. All of us were at some point, you know?
Right.
So,
well, I hate to say this to you folks, I'm sorry, but I think even Dylan O'Donnell, who I occasionally interact with, is a great guy. He's got a lot of great videos out there. He was talking about which scope do you buy. He has got a video on that. And he starts off with literally like, hey, if you're going to get into this and you think you're going to buy one scope, you're probably not going to be in this hobby. Because the fact is, if you get more into it, you probably are going to have a few scopes, honestly.
Yeah.
You know, you're going to have a few different things that you're running, you know,
as
you go on. I mean, sorry, I know it's like, really? But it's like, that's why it's so important for somebody like Daniel. He wants to try to get the good fit so you get excited about it. Somebody posted on Facebook Celestron page yesterday, what's the most popular accessory for a 6SE?
Right?
So people are putting stuff, you know.
I know what it would be.
But you know what I wrote?
I wrote,
the accessory that whatever gets you excited about astronomy to pull that thing out more often than not, and not leave it in the closet.
That's
the most important accessory you can have.
The accessory is you.
And it's funny because I did that, and then it's like all these people were like, yeah. But that's true, funny. Right? Like, at the end of the day, if most people, what they'll do is they'll look at it, and it's like, it can be a little tricky to get stuff set up and going. It's like, oh, I use it, and it goes in the closet, and I never use it again.
Well, there's an old saying, the best scope you'll ever own is the one you use.
The one you use.
It's the truest thing.
It's the truest thing.
Changes.
So, You gotta get into it. And there's been nights where Brent and I set up and it doesn't go well.
Right.
I've
had that nights too. I've had nights where it didn't go well for me too, or it was too cold. I just brought this scope out to John Hawk with Cal Arts. There was a bunch of students that came to the event and I set it up and I only looked at a couple objects that night with the kids because it was getting so cold, man.
Yeah.
You know, I was like 38. And the guys at East Coast are probably saying, you West Coast guys,
you
spoil run, you wimps.
I
can just hear Bill P. He'd be tearing me apart right now. He's out in 12 degree weather.
Are you guys kidding me right now?
We're wimps. Just like, it amazes me, these East Coast guys.
It's like the dew shield thing. Like, we don't use dew shields here. What are you talking about? Southern California? What do we do?
Yeah.
But yeah, it's just important, guys, to just think about, like, You gotta get into it, and there's gonna be some ups and downs, but
always ups and downs.
Always ups and downs.
There's gonna be mistakes. There's gonna be failures, dude. I have had so many failures. You know, mistakes that I've made, or things that I didn't see that I was planning to see, or weather, whatever it is, man. There's no free lunch. There's no free ride.
No.
You know, you gotta work for it. You know.
Are we okay, Brandon?
Yeah, I just gotta.
Okay.
You just gotta appreciate what each of these scopes do. You know,
That's right.
instruments are for. There's okay. some people that will laugh at me when I bring this thing up. They're like, "What are you kidding? What are you looking at this thing?"
Right, right, right.
But believe it or not, I'm looking at some things that you would probably be pretty mind-blowing if you knew more about them.
Well, and I will probably say, looking at this, I don't think they can't see it on camera. This Why? Is probably one of your more important ones that you'd love to use. Why? Because I think somebody autographed it.
Oh yeah, Hashimoto just came in. That's on video.
Mr. Takahashi. Mr. Hashimoto.
Well, one of the guys from Takahashi, okay. one of the representatives of Takahashi came to visit us.
And you guys can see it on camera here, guys, but he's basically got this thing signed.
I think
I
signed it. Yeah. So. This is funny. But yeah, the guys that talk sign these things. I've had a couple of the scopes signed, on the dew shields. I actually originally had purchased this telescope from Ed Ting from scopereviews.com. Ed Ting's a good friend of mine. I love Ed Ting. He's been a scope reviewer for many, many years. Him and Ed Ting and Todd Gross were actually the two pioneers that really started promoting, getting scope reviews out there. And his site still exists to this day. He just went to a trip to Chile, but he had this available, and I said, "I'm going to take it from you. I want it now." So
I'm gonna twist Daniel's arm. One stream, we're gonna get his talk set up. He's got an impressive collection of Takahashis, I will say. He does. And he's posted some videos and stuff, and I won't lie, like, there's been plenty of times where I've put up the video and just sit there and drool. You know what I mean?
So drool factor,
you know. So I'm gonna get him to do that. But I know what his point is that, you know, larger isn't always better.
It isn't,
you know?
It depends on really what you're trying to accomplish. You can look at the moon with this and have a lot of fun. You can look at tons of carbon stars and variable stars with just this little scope. There's actually, these guys are some of the most advanced double star observers in the planet. They use 60 millimeter refractors to do a lot of their observations, and they have a website for it. I'll probably have to put a post up.
Like I said, people just got to remember, I mean that Newtonian this reflector here that we just had out, I'd like to set that next to the one that Isaac Newton was using.
Yeah.
And the chances are Isaac's not even close to the quality of what that was. Look what he accomplished.
Amazing.
You know, and that's the whole
thing.
Like, people got to understand. It's like, you know, you get something a little smaller, you kind of get into it and start working your way through.
I want to tell you guys, just so that you know, Burnham, Celestial Handbook, this book is my favorite astro book in the world ever. And he is such a beautiful writer. If you knew the whole story of Robert Burnham Jr., it's an amazing story.
Heartbreaking, too.
It's a heartbreaking story. Yeah. This guy is the most amazing guy. He's my mentor. You know, this guy, what this guy did. He was so amazing. Real quick.
If you guys want those books, you can find them. They're on eBay.
Yeah.
Maybe
they're
Amazon.
Everywhere.
They're kind of everywhere.
You've
got to search around.
There's tons of them.
You've got to find them.
You've
got to go online.
Just Google them, you'll
Google
find
them. You'll find. But
they're
amazing. You can find them in great pristine. Like, all the ones I got on eBay or something, and I found people that
you can
really
find them in good condition. Get them in hardback, softback.
All that stuff, yeah.
I probably have like 30 of them sitting at home lying around.
You just got to search around, but you'll find them.
Point I wanted to make is people get into eyepieces. All the eyepieces that you see here are inch and a quarter barrel. And these are just some of them. I have many of them. I have whole collections of them. But the point that I want to make is that you don't need these big, colossal 2-inch eyepieces. It depends on the telescope. If you're using a telescope like this, it can help you to use 2-inch eyepieces and long focal lengths to get bigger swaths of the sky because the focal length is so long. So what happens is you find yourself trying to get a wider field of view. So you need to sometimes go into 2-inch eyepieces for them. But for the little scopes and refractors, I often use, probably more often than not, I'm using an inch and a quarter eyepiece probably 90% of the time I'm observing is with an inch and a quarter eyepiece.
The neat part too is if you buy some eyepieces, some decent ones or whatever you do,
you can use those for all the scopes. You can still use them for everything.
I don't have a whole lot, but I got a few. But you know what?
Well, they're there.
They're with me. They're not going anywhere. Like I'm going to use them.
You've had those for years. You can carry those eyepieces over.
I'm just going to use them. So you know. And there are, I was just trying to look. I got books all over the place here. You know, I was trying to find, is it right here? You sell this at your store.
That's by Bill P. That book's amazing. But, you just got it.
And I went through it. I actually read through this, using astronomical.
Yeah, that's
eyepieces.
My buddy Bill P. wrote that.
You want to know how important eyepieces are? Look at how thick that book is. And this book's amazing because it goes through any eyepiece out there.
I was a contributor to this book. I take great pride in that. I'm always going to say that.
But anything you're looking at, Naglers, anything, all kinds of stuff. It's like, it's all in there. Plossies, like all this kind of stuff.
Different eyepieces.
Different eyepieces are all in there. And all the manufacturers, basically.
Yeah, they have Konigs, Erflas, they have Orthos and Plossels. And yeah, they explain what all these eyepieces do, so you appreciate what they do.
Yeah, this
gotta
is extensive.
Gotta appreciate the subtleties.
For sure.
Now I know, and I gotta tell you, I know Dylan O'Donnell did that little photo versus visual thing, but you can, it was pretty funny to watch. It was pretty funny. But you can enjoy visual astronomy if you know what you're doing. And that takes time, figuring out how to do stuff, you know?
For sure. Well, it's all taking the time. I know, look, we're a challenged society. We want
everything.
We want our fix now, you know. Yeah. I mean, and I understand, I get it. You want to take a picture and see it right now, and you can do that.
Instant gratification.
You know? Totally awesome.
Or you can go to the Hubble website and just
look at you can do anything you want to do. But the whole point is, get into it. Yeah. You know, get into it. Do it. Enjoy
it. Get out there. Try to get out there.
Yeah.
Go to a Death Valley. Go to wherever it is dark. I don't know what's dark in the East Coast, but look at the Bortle scale online and see what's dark and get out there. Drive out somewhere and just look at the Milky Way.
Yeah.
And I feel sorry because, you know, back in the early days, everybody, you know, there wasn't as much light as what we have today. And they could see a lot of stuff, which sadly our culture just can't this current time.
No,
you know,
it's
unfortunately,
true.
Unless
it's
they go to a remote site.
But technology's unbelievable now, guys. I mean, the stuff we can do. I mean, look what I'm doing out of my backyard. I'm always blown away. I'm like, wow, I can't believe I'm actually able to measure and gather data on asteroids in my driveway.
Yeah, it's incredible.
It's incredible.
But technology
is allowing me to do that. Yeah. Otherwise, you know, I couldn't do it. You couldn't do that years ago. So the stuff is just amazing now and the resources. But it can be overwhelming too. It's like there's a lot of stuff out there. So,
there is. Yeah.
And
the more sophisticated it is, the chances are higher that more likely you'll have to spend time working with that sophisticated hardware. And then sometimes it will intrude on the night to a point where I'm like, you know what? I'll just put that aside. I'll just do visual and let somebody else do it if they enjoy it. And there's nothing wrong with that.
Right.
You know, I respect all of it.
For sure.
And were it not for astrophotographers, we wouldn't be in business because astrophotography takes up probably 50% of what we do, you know.
Oh, yeah. And most people I talk to, I mean, and my buddy Eric just bought a C8 from you, and he says, "Oh, I want I want a visual," but he also said he wants to take pictures, you know, some point. So it's like you do all kinds of stuff. But here's the cool part: all these telescopes, a lot of them will just do both.
Yeah, they do.
I mean, I can literally put a hyperstar on this, shoot asteroids.
Yes.
Pull the hyperstar off, and visually look at planets and look at anything I want through it, and do anything I want at a one scope. I don't have to have multiple things in that regard too. So.
Sure.
You know, but it's taken the time to appreciate both. I mean, before I ever bought a camera for that, I mean, I got pictures on my Instagram. Brandon and I mean, we're visually looking,
you know, a lot of people that come in get concerned about what kind of technology the scope has. And if you don't want to sit and learn and take the time to do it, I understand that and I get that. And you then get a computer automated scope that'll help, you know, take you to these objects.
Right.
That's not what this particular one is. What I have to do is look at an upside down image in here and rotate my maps upside down and train my eyes to hop from, you know, from star to star in the eyepiece. I don't mind doing that. I actually enjoy that, you know. So depends on how you want to approach it.
I mean, you can go. I mean, I even went crazy at one point too. I have, you guys can't see it, but I have a desk sitting over here that has star charts all over it. And I have even gone as deep as to, you know, draw and write on stuff, and these are all star charts.
Uranometria is a book I've used and still use to this very day. I mean, extensively.
Yeah. And I've gone through and marked out. I mean, I've marked out stuff
all
the things that we've been looking at.
Oh, I'll be darned.
You know, and those kinds of things. So,
wow. I didn't know that, Mike. I'm impressed.
Yeah, Brandon and I have spent some time
with
some of that.
Don't be afraid to write in your books.
Don't be afraid to write in the books. You know,
it's your history.
Care.
It's your life.
But I have star charts that I'll mark up too, you know,
I'd be
here.
Dead if I didn't have my books. You know, I'd be like, oh my God, everything would be away.
Well, but here's the thing. What it's kind of done too is helped me to navigate the sky. I mean, a lot of times I'm like, I'll go on the Minor Planet Center, like the one I'm looking at right now, and it's like one of the asteroids I'm trying to chase around. It's like, okay, and it gives me the RA, you know, and it gives me the coordinates.
Great.
And I'm like, without my knowledge of that, I would be like, okay. There's been times where I'm not sure, like, what time is that going to come up?
Oh,
I'm
yeah.
not sure.
Yeah.
I will go to my star chart and I'll go, okay, well, I know Arcturus is up.
Right.
Okay, where's Arcturus on my charts? Well, it's at 14. Like, okay, this one's measuring 18. Like, it's 4 hours behind. Like, okay. But if it wasn't for the charts,
this is good.
I wouldn't know where my asteroid is, what time it's going to come up.
It's great.
So
I'm telling you, I can't even tell you stress how special that is to just know that, because you appreciate those hours of right ascension. You start to visualize what time these things are coming up.
Yeah.
You know.
You have to.
Yeah, you have to. So you just—it's a cool thing to know that the computer isn't controlling you.
Right.
You know?
Oh, yeah.
You're kind of in charge.
Right.
You know?
Well,
so
and it goes back to just my appreciation of where we've come from. I mean, you know my all-time hero.
You have
hero.
A great...
You know my all-time hero.
I personally...
William Herschel is my guy. And you know what? That's honestly... I read the Georgian Star book. It's a small book. Anybody can get that on Amazon.
Yeah.
I read through that book and probably my whole library... grew from that point on. It just took off. I read the book 3 times. I loved it so much. That's how crazy I am. When I started reading about him and Caroline, I'm like, wow. Like,
it's amazing.
It's amazing.
I don't take it for granted what these people went through.
They're just amazing.
You know, the Herschels, the whole family were just amazing.
Yeah.
And now we have Sue French, who, by the way, she's just a wonderful person. Yeah, I saw them in New York. Neil and Sue French did this book. These are the columns from Sky and Telescope's monthly column, Deep Sky Wonders, that she uses.
Yeah.
And most of the observations she does in here are from a 4-inch refractor, 5-inch refractor, and a 10-inch Newtonian. And she covers all the months. It's really great. Goes by season. So really nice books. I highly recommend to take a look at. By the way, I got to show you my atlas here. I got to show you this. You ready? The Interstellarium. Okay. Check this out. This is like the new Uranometria, but so beautifully done as well. And these are detailed maps with 1-degree squares, and they cover the northern and southern hemisphere. And these, it's like it's not paper. It's like a plastic material.
Okay.
It doesn't do it, but they're really beautiful, and they highlighted the colors.
On them. Yeah. Nice.
But sometimes I have to go to Uranometria for specific reasons. It's too long to explain, but you just find yourself loving both of them. And then there's a companion to the by the way, this is the Interstellarium Atlas, if I didn't hold it up.
Do you have this at your store? Or?
We don't sell it.
That one, okay.
Yeah, no, we don't. But you have to get it online.
So you got to go online and find that one. Okay.
Amazing. Okay. Then this is the Deep Sky Guide, and this has all the objects.
Look at that.
This is beautiful. Amazing. This is the companion. I actually helped.
Let me get this. Yeah. Let me get a little close-up of this so you guys can kind of see.
That's by Cambridge Press. And I actually had corresponded to contribute to help make this this companion.
Love it.
Which is really cool.
Amazing.
So I had worked with Cambridge. Anyway, I think, you know, hopefully we've covered enough material that people have an idea of telescopes.
Well, and we're just getting started too, man. I mean, we're getting the channel started, man. We're going to have all kinds of
fun stuff.
But you gotta
see Brian Cogdell, man.
Brian
Cogdell is the man.
You know,
such a nice guy. We used to work together at Celestron.
We're gonna talk. We're gonna talk a lot of Mead stuff with him and that kind of thing. And but yeah, you know, get out there, guys.
Get out there and observe.
You know, and again,
sit down in a lawn chair.
And if you have questions, like, hey, you can call the doctor at
toll free at 888-427-8766 and ask for Dr. D. That's me.
Dr. D. You know, you can call Daniel. You can go online. There's lots of resources out there on stuff. I mean, there's a lot of videos on things.
A lot of fun.
You know, I spend a lot of hours looking at YouTube videos on products that I'm interested in.
Yeah.
Just to see how
there's so much information
now
on YouTube.
Out there, you know,
you can pick
out
just about any telescope in YouTube. But I watch YouTube like 90% of the time.
Yeah.
I'm watching.
You gotta take the time and you know what? There's investment in it to understand what's going on. But I promise you, if you spend the time and learn it. And own it.
It's very rewarding.
It's rewarding, man. Like, think about what you're doing. I mean, that's the whole thing. We're visually looking, or visually looking, or imaging, or whatever we're doing in the night sky. It's an
beautiful.
Incredible thing. It's a beautiful thing out there, man. And you got to take the time and don't be afraid. You know, and don't think of it either as like, okay, I got to just find the perfect scope. It's like, you know what? You may go through one or two things, or you might try something and use it for a while and go, you know what, I want to get into this. And I think Daniel has a great buyback program too. And you can exchange and do, I mean,
we have people
that Claudia Knights has used equipment. I mean, there's so many things, guys, but you just got to get in there
no shortage
and do it and don't be afraid, you know. yeah. of what you're doing.
People get intimidated by it. They get discouraged.
Yeah.
You know, they can't see things. They rely heavily on the automation of telescopes sometimes. I don't like to make it my God. I've made a very stringent point to keep it separated and keep it in its in perspective.
Well, and I'm fortunate. I have this setup that you guys see here. This is a Los Mondi, but basically, you know, I have digital setting circles on here, but there's no computer control. Like I don't push a button and it motor drives. I have to physically move the telescope where it's going to go. Now it'll track. It's the same kind of situation like this where you point it and then it starts tracking. It'll do that, but the whole point was just when I came to Daniel, man, I guess it's been a year and a half ago that I got this, and I said I want something bulletproof, you know, and I want something where I have to force myself to look at star mats and think about what I'm really trying to look at and focus on.
I wanted you to have this thing, to keep your morals in check, man.
I did. And I love it, man. I mean, I love that mount. That mount is amazing. So, but again, it's just about me trying to take the time to learn some of this stuff and understand it, you know. But you guys got to do that. You got to spend the time.
I remember that night you went out to the house and you called me. You're like, hey, dude, I'm seeing things at work.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know what was cool that night? I have a house out by Palm Springs, out kind of a dark sky location.
Yeah.
We were looking at Comet 46P, the Christmas comet.
There was. I think it was. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's 46P.
You saw it.
We saw it. And my 8-year-old daughter saw it with our 8-inch with that mount.
Yeah.
And basically I just kind of figured out where the coordinates was, where it's going to be, and I pointed the scope and I didn't, it was, you know, it was one of those things where it was like, there's no way. This thing had been, was so far away at this point, you know, it was like, I look in the eyepiece and there's the fuzz and I'm like,
I know.
But there's the comet right there.
But what that fuzz is.
But I'm like, that's the comet. Like,
yeah, it's crazy.
It was like, there it is. You know, and I saw the
there's
fuzzies,
a sense
like,
of
there's
excitement
the comet.
From that.
So, and then I showed my daughter and she's, I said, what do you see? You know, and she starts telling me, and I'm like, yep, that's the comet. And we sat there for, Brandon, we were there for hours, right? I mean, we were looking at the comet all night, man. It was just awesome. So, you know, it's just a great thing.
You had a good time.
Man. Good time, you know,
I've
for
had
sure.
great memories. I've had sad memories, but great memories in the hobby. So,
yeah, for sure.
More of a way of life. It's not really a hobby to me. It's more of a way of life.
How long we've been going, Brandon?
An hour
and
18.
Okay, well.
Good enough.
Pretty good.
I mean, I think we covered a lot of material. I can't think of, at the moment, anything extra that we need
to
cover.
Well, again, guys, you like what you see, please subscribe. You know, we're going to continue hunting asteroids, and we'll have more imaging sessions and more visual talks with Daniel and just other guests that we have. We're doing all kinds of stuff here.
And congrats on those submissions.
Thank you.
When you mentioned it to me, it reminded me of submissions I made to AVSO, which is the American Association of Variable Star Observers, the visual observations which I had sent in 20 odd years ago or something. And they sent me a certificate. And it was
cool. It's a neat deal because they have the Minor Planet Center has a new ADES format they just started this where you actually. You used to be able to email.
He knows more about asteroids now than I'll ever know.
And now you create this actual file format and you upload it to them. And when I first did it, it was like, I get these errors, you know. Nope, you got to do it. It's like, and then I do it and it says, submission correct. Like, oh, and it's like, it went through. And then, you know, a little while later you wait and then all of a sudden you get an email. Like, your submissions are accepted in and here's an observatory code application. Like, oh man, like, okay,
that's
you
cool.
know. So it's just, it's a neat deal.
There's a sense of gratification with that.
Well, we feel like we're doing some scientific research. And
we're doing, you're contributing
for
something
us,
of yourself.
Yeah, I'm you know, look, I totally respect the guys that take the pictures, man. It's been all night. I mean, that's incredible.
Sure.
You know,
so work of labor.
Those guys, Mirko and those guys, Simon, like they spend the time out there. The Dylan O'Donnells, the Astro Backyard Trevors, all those guys, incredible.
Yeah.
And amazing.
Sure.
For me, I'm not super into that.
Right.
I like the visual thing a lot because I appreciate.
You like the history.
The history. Like I'm all about the history. So, and when I'm observing these asteroids and taking measurements and doing, I literally feel like I'm in the history books, like doing that. You know.
You are. You're leaving a bit of your history behind.
I noticed on what is it? The
AWB?
What's the telescope that we just did?
The AWB 130, the Newtonian.
Newtonian, right? Their website. He had some books on there. He had The Glass Universe, I just saw.
That's fantastic.
Amazing.
Glass Universe
is amazing.
I have it too.
Oh my gosh. Everybody's got to read that. So when I'm doing that, I feel like, oh man, this is like, This is the girls, man. This is the computers. This makes you appreciate. These are all these guys that were doing this stuff back in the days, you know. It's incredible.
The sad part is sometimes the lack of appreciation.
Yeah, so, for sure. So. All right, guys. Well, thanks for watching. And again, we'll leave links to the Discord. We're going to put a link to the Newtonian, $200, man. And any questions, please, telescopes.net. And we also have a promo code, Asteroid Hunter. If you go to telescopes.net and you're looking for some equipment, you put it in the cart, put in the Asteroid Hunter promo code, you're going to get a discount on your order. Yeah, some stuff that's already on sale and stuff you won't, but depends. A lot of stuff just depends. You'll get an actual discount.
Eric got it.
You know, yeah, with that promo code. So please punch it in there, man. We're grateful for them for supporting the channel and helping us out. And thanks for coming out, man.
Yeah, and thank you, AWB. You know?
Yeah.
We think so highly of AWB. So.
Absolutely. And what a great cause. I mean, guys, get on that that website. We'll leave that link down there. And Astronomers Without Borders. And purchase that Newtonian, man. I love
it. It's awesome.
It's so awesome. So, all right, guys. Well, thanks for coming by and have a great rest of the weekend. We'll see you again.